How are you doing, Joe?
I'm doing great. Thank you. First of all, thank you very much for coming on our now annual cruise. We're doing it. We're gonna do another one next year, and I hope everybody's having a good time. You know, when they when we first signed up for this, you know, like, this blues boy doesn't float, you know, and last year we I got to walk around and meet a lot of you guys. Well, I met everybody. Sorry about that. I just couldn't do that again. How many people on the meet and greet today? 2,600. Wait a minute. And I went and I got to see everybody, and I saw how much fun everybody was having, and I said, well, you know what, it's worth a couple of Dramamine and these funky wristbands to come back and do it again. So I'm glad you guys are here, very much so. So I should start by admitting something to you all, and anybody who follows me on Instagram or Facebook or Twitter or Snapchat, or any of the other various social media options that we have now, I am a bona fide guitar addict. Thank you very much. I have had this addiction since I've been a kid. My father twice ran a guitar shop, and I was just enthralled with music, and I was enthralled with vintage guitars. I loved old guitars. I loved old Fender amps. And as a kid, I would sit there and I'd go through these books and I'd go through these catalogs and these old vintage guitar magazines with these big lists of guitars and prices that I couldn't afford, and would just spend hours and hours and hours in my room going, this is what I want to be around. You know, I don't care how I'm going to be around it, but I know I want to, you know, one of these days I want to touch a 1959 Sunburst Les Paul. One of these days I want to play through a Tweed Fender amp. I don't know how I was going to do it. And around 1989, we were called out to do a television show called Into the Night with Rick Dees, which was on ABC. Oh, yeah. And I was this little kid involved in a skit with a Barney Fife impersonator and the band Billy Vera and the Beaters. And my dignity aside, I was able to take my first trip to Los Angeles, is where I live now. And I remember going to the guitar shops on Sunset Boulevard, and it would be the Guitar Center, there would have been Albert Molinaro's store called Guitars R Us. There was literally, you could spend the afternoon, it's a shell of itself now, there's only Guitar Center left, but back in those days, you could go and you could basically window shop the whole afternoon, and then you would eat tacos at El Compadre, and for a fat 12-year-old, this was living. And that's where I saw my first Fender, you know, blonde neck Fender Stratocaster from the 50s, the first Tweed amp, the first things that I was, you know, actually touching and playing the guitars that I would see in these books living in upstate New York. And finally, towards the end of the trip, a nice person that was taking us around and helping us out mentioned something. He goes, hey, you know what? If you like this stuff on Sunset Boulevard, you should really go see Norma. And I'm like, Dad, can we drive out and see Norman? And he's like, sure, son. And we took a drive into the valley, and we went to Norm's Rare Guitars. And when I tell you, Norman has always had the best of the best. And it was the first time I met Norman. It was the first time I got to see the best of the best and, you know, look at things that I could only imagine seeing in a book, you know, but they were right next to it, you know. So when the idea came up to talk to Norman about, you know, collecting, that I said, you know, we should share some of these stories, you know, and I think, you know, some of you guys would really get a kick out of them. So without further ado, I give you a legend in the guitar business, Norm Harris from Norm's Rare Guitars.
Thank you, Jim.
Thank you. Thank you for being here, Norm. And, you know, Norm and I have been friends for 25 years or more. And to prove it, Norman kept, you know, I mean, what a fucking ego I had when I was 12. Because I was a nobody. I was this little fat blonde kid running around Southern California with a Telecaster on television with Billy Vera and the Beaters and a radio personality named Rick Dees. But I had 8x10 glossies. And I had such an ego that I felt the need to sign one for the shop. Can we see that slide, please? Oh, did they? Can you go back? There it is. What an ego on that boy. So, about 3 years ago, Norm brings it out, and I couldn't believe it, that you kept it all these years. You may have saw something in me that I didn't even realize, but thank you for keeping that. You know, it's a very cool piece of memorabilia.
Well, I did see it, and when Phil first came in, and he started picking up some guitars and playing, I was going, this kid's a freak. I mean, you know, and he played like crazy. And he loved his old stuff that, you know, young kids just didn't get it, you know. He came in and he was like, can I see this? Can I play this? And can I touch this? And I loved it, you know, because it kind of showed me where the future is going to be. And I just would like to say one thing. I've known Joe for many years, and I'm so proud of him because besides being one of the greatest players, he's also one of the greatest guys.
Interesting, you know, some people that know me very well and knew me when I was 12 and know me now, and I'm almost 40 years old, I really haven't matured or changed at all from that point. The same dude. So Norm
has... That's what I love about him.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, his mom is sitting over here, Deborah, and she said to me the other day, listen, can yeah, grandparents, Len and Deborah over there, and... And his mom said, listen, can you help Joe, I mean, you know, can you get him to stop buying guitars? So I said, yeah, I have both my fingers crossed, sorry.
She's like, I keep telling him, you need a 401k. Not everybody needs a Les Paul.
So, one of the great things about collecting in general, and all of this, is the story. You know, a guitar is a guitar. Now, you're looking at a 59 Les Paul Standard and a...
Joe Bonamassa.
Les Paul. From Epiphone. Now, one is a $300,000 guitar, and one is a $500 guitar. And the thing is, once you get... They all sound... pretty much within the same 10%, but it's the story and the soul and the history that has been, you know, ingrained in these old things that kind of gets us collectors addicted, you know?
And they were pulling people in off the streets to try to teach them how to build a guitar because they had so much demand, they couldn't keep up with it.
And, you know, people also needed things like chairs and kitchen tables, you know, not just guitars. Although, my house...
You eat off of a guitar.
I sit on an amp and eat it. You know, my kitchen table is a guitar, so I think there's nothing wrong with it. Sometimes, my girlfriend will tell you, we'll be watching a movie, and like, immediately, I begin yelling at the television. Why? Because if there's ever a band playing, and it's supposed to be the 1950s or the 1960s, and somebody's up there with some fucking reissue, I start yelling at the TV. Now, am I Elvis Presley? Do I shoot the television? No, I do not. But I do stand up in righteous indignation going, can I get in touch with the continuity person and have a conversation. It's not that hard. One of the movies that I think the folks would know would be Spinal Tap. And a great vintage guitar movie, also a great movie in rock and roll. I remember being on a tour in 2003, and it was the first time we ponied up and rented a tour bus. And we went out, and when I tell you, the shows weren't selling, folks. We were playing for the door, and they weren't selling. We kind of ran out of steam, and the tour was just going really flat and bad. And I remember being on the bus, and we put on Spinal Tap, and we were watching it. And not, it was the only time I didn't laugh at the movie, because their tour was going better than mine.
Just to fill you in, right at the front of the Holiday Inn, it said, puppet show and Spinal Tap.
Yes. These are the guitars that I play live now. So this one is what we call Spot, and I've had this for about 5 years, and it's a 59 Les Paul, and the double white coils, basically it's just what's underneath the chrome covers, you know. Some of them had two black coils, some of them had one white coil, one black coil, they call that a zebra. These are the double creams, which a guy named Larry DiMarzio now owns the patent on them, so it's, you know, don't clap, it's a pain in the ass. Dave Larry makes everybody's life harder. This guitar I play live, and you know, it's been played. Obviously it's not mint condition. I have a few at home that are mint, and you know, the thing about when I started basically spending all my money on these, and people think I'm a very wealthy person, which I'm not. I'm actually just a guitar addict with a credit card. And I said to myself, well, I'm gonna go out and play them. I love them. It's what I wanna make music on. And the very first one I bought, a cheeky fellow, let's just say, came up to me and said, I had paid $165,000 for a guitar. And I said, it was, by the way, it was more than all the money I had in the world. I was in debt, I was in hock, I pawned my shoelaces, that's why I wear Vans. And I said, and the guy comes to me and goes, you know, every scratch you put on the guitar takes $1,000 off the value. And I said to myself, well, if I scratch it 165 times, is it worthless? And then I said, no. So then I just put it on, and I played, and we took it to the Beacon Theater, and I've taken them to the Albert Hall, and I've taken them all around the world. And I'm safe to assume that this is the only 59 Les Paul in the middle of the Gulf of Mexico at the moment. So what I'd like, what I thought I'd do, because you'd probably be like, well, maybe I'll play a little for you, is kind of show you some of the riffs that were made famous by these type of guitars, you know, starting, hold on, sorry. By the way, I have the amp behind the curtain because it's like, so loud. Anyway. So basically, so that's like the first time you've ever heard a real 59 Les Paul when you hear Zeppelin, you know, or you hear Fleetwood Mac. Drunk on slow gin, eating Fritos, and playing through a Tweed amp, you know?